people like this take over.
I really just wanted to let you guys know how infuriating the fact that people still call Eilish the difference and the change in the music industry.
I don't know how old she is. She looks like she's 20. Like some 20-year-old drugged up skate.
Opinions about the whole adding an accent to your singing when you don't have an accent.
I heard her initial EP last year. I thought it was boring as hell. The instrumentals lacked life.
First of all, she's a terrible person. She's absolutely terrible. Number two, her music is horrible. Her music is worse than she is as a person, but she's a terrible, terrible person.
I didn't really hear a single hit on that whole thing.
It's like she's adding some sort of like British accent to it when she doesn't have a British accent.
Like, come on, y'all be letting the weakest artists come out.
Something that I don't expect someone like Billie Eilish.
Billie
Eilish.
I wish it was her that had a seizure at Chicago O'Hare Airport and not Juice WRLD. And I don't even like Juice WRLD. I mean, his music was garbage too.
The commercial success of Billie Eilish is without a doubt one of the most interesting cases I've ever seen in the music industry. In this biography, I'm going to extensively break down Eilish's rise to fame and every major influence and effort of hard work it took to get to where she is today. By her 15th birthday, she was already signed to Interscope and took the record for youngest artist to break and win all four award-winning field categories. But how? In order to understand her rise to fame, we have to go back to where it started. Billie Eilish pirate Baird O'Connell is currently 19 years old, and within her short period of fame, she's become one of the world's biggest artists, dominating the electropop genre and winning 5 out of 6 of her potential Grammy wins. She's grown over 73.5 million Instagram followers and 51 million monthly Spotify listeners, sparring with decades-old legend Drake, who's only over 100,000 shy of the number 11th most listened to artist in the world. But Billie wasn't always topping charts and dominating the industry.
Hi, my name is Billie, and I'm going to play a song that I made up with this guitar.
Billie was raised in a house of four in Highland Park, Los Angeles. Unlike many siblings growing up, Eilish's best friend was her older brother Finneas. Her and Finneas wrote songs and often sang together, joining on stages at venues. Their parents, Maggie Baird and Patrick O'Connell, were short of being in the limelight, when Maggie being a screenwriter and voice actor, even playing in Broadway, and Patrick an actor and voice actor as well.
Nothing makes you tense like thousands of people wanting to kill you.
With the success of the long-married couple, Eilish and Finneas were homeschooled, giving them the time to hone in on their creative side. The house was littered with a plethora of instruments both Maggie and Patrick knew how to play. But even with the amateur knowledge of basic keys and strings, Billie and Finneas used their time and creativity to their advantage. Although Eilish wasn't enrolled in a school, she still hung out with other homeschooled kids her age. She even had a love for horses, picking up a job working stables, and decided to join a dance class. Eventually, as fate had it, she obtained an injury forcing her to leave dance and become a full-time stay-at-home teenager. Little did she know, this would be the injury that changed her life forever.
So this trash-ass emo drug addict, she says, I like Sade, so let me try to copy Sade, but let me hire a Eastern European trash producer to make my horrible beats, rap music beats, whatever you want to call it. And that's what she did. Trash.
I've been watching you for some time. Can't stop staring at those ocean eyes.
Even though Billie couldn't dance the same, she'd still go on to contribute her talent by recording a song to choreograph and dance to. And by the young age of 13, Billie recorded her hit single Ocean Eyes with her older brother Finneas, to which then released on SoundCloud with the intent of her music teacher hearing it. However, during the short period after dropping the song, thousands had already streamed it. Oh, Did I forget to mention Billie's been writing her own songs since 11 and learned how to sing in a choir? During Eilish's rise to fame, some of her first performances included venues such as SoFar Sounds and the Observatory, one in particular being Rickshaw Stop in San Francisco on behalf of Aaron Axelson, a famous DJ and former radio host in the Bay Area who's the owner of Pop Scene, which Eilish eventually played at herself. But this wasn't until she had released her first full-length project after being signed to Interscope Records in November of 2016. Once signed, it was set in stone for Billie's potential to slam on an international level, landing her a spot in the history books as another generational artist. Billie was now signed under Darkroom Records, a management company under Interscope's belt. However the case, Interscope still had an eye on Eilish before they decided to hand her the contract. With her new management team, Darkroom re-released an early song that never blew up called 6 Feet Under, along with re-releasing Ocean Eyes. 6 Feet Under eventually caught up to Ocean Eyes, becoming her first big songs in her career. In August of 2017, Billie had spent 9 months preparing her first major project, Don't Smile at Me, which debuted at number 185 on Billboard 200, climbing to number 97 almost 2 months after its release. The 9-track EP, now sitting on global charts, was Billie's first introduction to the mainstream world, with sleeper hits such as Copycat and Bellyache peaking on Hot 100 for over a month. With Eilish's new influence on the industry, she expanded her indie pop sound and made a single for season 1 of 13 Reasons Why, including collaborating with other artists such as Khalid and Vince Staples, ultimately opening the door for new audiences. By the end of 2018, Billie had performed in Canada, Germany, the UK, Japan, Italy, and many more, which was a huge jump from the release of a song made in a bedroom solely for her music teacher to hear.
Garbage ass music. This fucking broad, this little skank, she was on one of those late night talk shows and they were talking about whatever. And this was just a clip that I seen online. Supposedly Billie Eilish did not know who the Eagles were. So this late night left-wing moron says, you never heard of the Eagles? She goes, Who are they? So, okay, you don't need to know who the Eagles are, but here's the thing. When you're in the music industry, but to be so ignorant and just like so blasé, like you don't care about who the Eagles are. Again, even though they are overrated, Eagles, I mean, I almost want to say they suck.
You might be asking yourself, what does this have to do with the genius of Billie Eilish? Well, I've already explained some of why I find her this way. What made her so special for Interscope to sign her at 14 will be explained soon, but in order to understand the genius of Billie, I had to review her backstory so we have an idea of who she is as a person. The final product of an artist is the conclusion of who they are as people. Their ideas, thoughts, actions, all contribute to the music. So now that we've covered the come up of a teenage girl whose domain is an entire pop genre, we're gonna go over how I stumbled on Billie and break down both of her projects, reviewing lyrics, mood, influence, marketing, sound choice, and character. I'll be explaining what makes her fans fans and why I became one myself. I'll admit, I didn't like Billie Eilish at first, and as of recent, I've just gotten into her music, but for the past few months I've been inspired by her story and creativity that I needed to understand why. Why was I so ignorant to an artist of this versatility, this obvious? The standard of music I put myself at was strictly limited. Don't get me wrong, as ignorant as I can be sometimes, I'm still open ears for different genres, but for some reason, Billie Eilish was never an option. As I was casually scrolling through Instagram and saw something that looked oddly familiar, Billie Eilish had put out a single titled, Therefore I Am, and so I watched a clip on her page. This minute video intrigued me somehow, and why did the title bring me back to a time where I felt judged? Over time, I grew respect for Eilish when I'd unwillingly see her marketing team go to work, especially after seeing her not respond to haters saying she has a mid-30s wine mom body. And that was inspiring for me. With enough 30-second clips of her doing random things on Instagram, I finally decided to give her a chance and clicked on the link for her day-old music video. The way this was filmed followed her around an empty mall, which reminded me of Sam Mendes' 1917, a movie seen together as if it were one long shot with no cuts nor changing camera angles. I always knew Billie had a gifted voice, but apparently that went over my head too. The lyrics were simplistic and rebellious, juxtaposing the visuals played for comic relief while all holding a vibe of sex appeal. Wow, how is she so choreographed with her movements? How did they get them all to themselves? Why did she eat everything but the fucking pretzel? This wasn't another industry plant. No, this was an industry plant done right. A breath of fresh air. Then it happened. When I saw Eilish stuffing her face with french fries and obnoxiously laughing into the camera, I finally understood what this video meant, and I fell in love with her instantly. In the year 2000, when Eminem was rising to fame, he dropped The Way I Am, which in sum is mainly about the negative perceptions of people's opinions and how he'll always be shamed for who he is, which is why he says, "You say I am. If I wasn't, then why would I say I am? In the paper, the news, every day I am." And he doesn't care who talks, because at the end of the day, they'll talk no matter what, which is why he don't give a fuck. So put my tape back. Billie Eilish took the message of Eminem's song and put her own twist on it. Like a complete badass, she clapped back at the haters for body shaming her with the song that took her to the AMAs. If this isn't the definition of poetic justice, I don't know what it.
Shut the fuck up with that garbage-ass music. I hope a lot of you guys get triggered. I hope you guys get emotionally bent and scarred from this video, because you guys are just this. If you guys are a fan of that music, if you guys are fans of that horrible, horrible music, that's fine. You gotta take the L, though. You know that music's trash. You know that music's trash. You know, at first, when Little Peep died,
in 2017, Billie dropped her first full-body project, Don't Smile At Me, a 9-track EP with one feature. The EP's production is one of a kind, with Eilish being the first big in the electropop genre since Lady Gaga, showing off her future potential for upcoming artists inspired by her sound. The entire EP feels sincere, but has its cocky moments throughout each track, making it feel as though Billie has emotional leverage over whoever she's singing about. For example, the lyric, "I'll sit and watch your car burn. Is suggesting she won't be hurt without avenging the emotion caused by said person. It's this kind of attitude in her lyrics that make the music fun, while contrasting a subtle message in each line. The first track, Copycat, opens on a diss to a particular person who bit Eilish's style shortly after she blew up, clothing-wise and musically. In almost what feels like an early 2000s Good Girl Gone Bad theme, the instrumental borrows its unique sound from modern-day trap with hi-hats and gritty sub-bass. In the music video for the second track, I Don't Wanna Be You Anymore, Billie challenges her own image as she sings the lyrics in a reflection of herself. She's confronting the person in the mirror, her fear of breaking someone's heart, telling it, "I don't wanna be you anymore." The message in this song juxtaposes the first track's meaning, how someone else wants to be her, the person she doesn't. The kind of consistency between the first two tracks is what makes the music hit. From here on out, Billie stays consistent with this type of passive-aggressive lyricism. Her image during the time matches perfectly with the kind of behavior she portrays in the EP. Her RBF combined with baggy exaggerated clothing is what makes this smiling half-naked model the opposite of this one. This is why Interscope signed her. Yeah, because they saw potential in a 13-year-old's voice, but just as a record label should, they bet on an artist to make them money and give us great music. Remember, it's not just the music that makes the music great, it's the artist behind it, and every one of them has a character and an image to uphold. For Billie to be this young and mature to be making this kind of music with the subject matter of someone who's lived through two divorces is why she has the attention she does. A majority of her fans are under 18, and without a doubt wouldn't understand how being an adult works. That's why there's a divide between the old school and the new school. Once you separate the artist from the fans, you come to realize Billie Eilish is unlike anybody out right now, or ever in that matter. What other songs on the EP have you noticed contrast with each other? In the comments below, break down your favorite Eilish song and what they mean to you. In early 2019, she dropped her first studio album, When We Fall Asleep, Where Do We Go? With the full force of a label on her back, they pushed this album's marketing to the max with playlists, music videos, live performances, and jumbo screens, bringing its first week's sales to debut at number one on Billboard's 200s chart. With her new album heavily inspired by the Babadook, Billie took direction with her next project by blending electropop and dark pop with songs like When the Party's Over and Bury a Friend, dominating the charts with Bad Guy going 6-time platinum, being her biggest song to date. Without question, Billie had the best album of 2019 and won 5 Grammys for her performance on it. As controversial as that was, I for once agreed with the Grammys' decision, and why, you might ask? Just like Therefore I Am, it all boils down to subject matter. On the track Bad Guy, she plays with the idea of being the one who seduces all the guys rather than the other way around. And the quirky sounds of the chorus imply she's not being serious, it's all jokes. On the track Zanny, Billie talks about the use of drugs and how the people who use them are too high to be scared for the health. She explains how uncomfortable she feels having to deal with secondhand smoke, and as much as their quote-unquote pretty heads hurt, she wants no part in it. Another example, and one of my favorites, in Listen Before I Go, Billie weighs down on the pressures of fame by walking on a rooftop ready to jump. She confronts her friends, telling them she's sorry because what she's about to do next can't be forgiven. Although suicidal subject matter is implied, I take the song's meaning as a double standard. One meaning the obvious that she's going to take her life, and two, she's leaving her friends behind for a new life called fame. As if falling off the roof is like jumping into a crowd of fans, getting carried away for good. What's beautiful about these tracks aren't the fact they deal with modern day issues, but where she stands on the matter. Seduction, drugs, and suicide being the 3 songs I talked about. Just like the EP, Billie stays consistent by cameoing one song in another.
Said I couldn't love someone, cause I might break. If you're gonna die, not by mistake. My friends aren't far, in the back of my car lay their bodies. Bury a friend, try to wake up. Can't stop staring at those ocean eyes. Fell for these ocean eyes. You should see me in a crowd.
Her roots stem from a variety of artists such as the Beatles and Avril Lavigne. I believe Intro to Party Favor was inspired by Marvin's Room, and Hostage reminds me of the indie artist Massive Attack Paradise Circus, the dubstep remix. I'd like to appreciate how consistent she's been throughout her years, on top of being in the right places at the right times. Nonetheless, becoming something most people watching this could only dream of becoming. Well, don't feel so bad. Billie is a workaholic. She's so dedicated, she's literally went on tour with 2 sprained ankles. She was never a self-proclaimed artist either, because she did have help on her come-up. Yes, her parents basically groomed her to become who she is by keeping her in homeschool, teaching her instruments, putting her in a choir, and already having knowledge in the entertainment business. But they're what made her their daughter, not Billie Eilish. If Billie didn't have this one single person in her life, she would be untapped talent nobody would have heard of, nor be on the level she's on today. So who might that be, may you ask?
This is it, the final piece in the genius of Billie Eilish. The nail in the coffin, the proof in the pudding. This isn't what, but who made Billie who she is today. For those diehard Eilish fans out there who've noticed the single most important person I've been avoiding to mention, now you know why. Finneas O Connel, currently 23 years old, has been the engineer and writer of Ocean Eyes, including every Eilish song till now. Finneas is the older brother any sibling could ask for. I mean, who wouldn't want an older brother who can produce multi-platinum hits for you? While Eilish was in dance or choir, Finneas had his own band, and unlike a 1950s marriage, they broke up. Finneas went solo, creating and singing his own music while putting the rest into his sister's talent. A common thread in the community has always been the debate of ghostwriting, having others write your music for you while you perform the song and take the credit. But with the late controversy of artists such as Drake and Kanye West being shunned on for such accusations, other old-school rappers such as Lil' Kim, Eazy-E, Dr. Dre, Snoop Dogg, and Diddy have came out and admitted it, to name a few. But keep in mind, Billie and Finneas aren't in the rap game. They're just 2 kids who wrote songs together in their rooms. No sessions, no complicated relations, no paying for studio time. Just a brother and sister with a passion for music and art that learned their way around software called Fruity Loops. Told you not to worry.
One of my favorite productions by Finneas is Ilo Milo, inspired by the video game. With Finneas being a producer, it's easy for him to predict the pattern of an instrumental and where you want to go with it. But to commence a track like this one, as simplistic as it is impressive, must have been difficult. Too close to stars, they're never gonna give you love like ours. The overlapping of both the percussion and piano fails to line up, making the track's first listen unpredictable, without throwing random instruments and keys into the mix. Skipping sounds of the synth help give it a haunting feeling, almost as if I'm drifting through space while floating in water.
Or maybe it's my eyes.
Or in their vision, sinking in an ocean filled with unidentified monsters, a common theme Billie likes to play on since her first song, Ocean Eyes. With Finneas being a backup vocalist for her over the years, I'm surprised they haven't composed a track together. The closest song to it would be Everything I Wanted, a track made in perspective of Finneas comforting Billie after a bad dream where everyone took her for granted. The talks of constantly drowning is one way of staying consistent.
So I stepped off the golden. As long as I'm here, no one can hurt you.
Finneas was there the entire time, guiding Eilish and helping her cope with the pressures of fame. He's an artist himself, but never knew the pressure until his little sister stepped into it. Without Eilish, there's no Finneas, and without Finneas, there's no Eilish, and they've really been in it since day one, that they even make the same facial expressions when singing. In conclusion, the entire discography of Billie Eilish was explored in more areas than others, but without question, leaves us with the answer that she is one of this generation's best, if not the best. It's crazy for me to think the slim chance of her existence as a mainstream artist was possible, even with her biggest song completely missing a chorus. With Eilish's sound in the mainstream world heavily relying on the electro-pop and dark pop genre, I hope to hear something new as well as something familiar. With her The World's a Little Blurry documentary coming out tomorrow, I hope we get a hint at a new project for later this year. No matter how good an artist's music can be, transparency is something very few accomplish, and Billie Eilish, without a doubt, is a first-generation prodigy. But hey, who the hell am I? For more research on this artist, several links are below I recommend watching. Let me know what you think about Billie in the comments below, and if I should continue the Genius Of series. If so, who'd you like for me to break down next? This was my first video essay, so to show support, subscribe and ring the bell to be updated on new content dropping next month.
You know, I swear to God, I wanted to leg drop her. I wanted to leg drop her. I don't know. I'm calling it up. I'm calling it right now. She's going to be the next one up on The Price Is Wrong. Okay, she's gonna have some issues very, very soon. Billie Eilish, trash ass music. I'm Black Bigot and you're not.